The Golden Temple in India, one of the most beautiful buildings on earth. For millions of Sikhs like me, this is holy ground. But just over 25 years ago, it was a bloody battlefield. Tanks stormed the complex to capture this man, Jurnail Singh Bhindranwale. To some, he was a defender of the Sikh faith.
He was a great saint and great soldier.
To others, he was a militant who terrorized for long enough.
He may have started as a saint, but he didn't end as a saint, let me tell you that.
It was Indira Gandhi who gave the order to capture Bhindranwale and began a chain of events that would lead to thousands of deaths, including her own. Many Sikhs call this their own 9/11. I'm going back to the madness of 1984 to find out why neighbours became enemies and how a sacred shrine became a killing ground.
It was like firing at St Paul's Cathedral in London.
This journey will lead me to victims.
Palu, palu, la, 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 karti. Khoon da badla khoon.
And heroes.
I feel proud that I have saved one life.
And will make me see my own faith in a new way.
Jesse.
10 years ago, I was visiting India with my family and we went to the Golden Temple. I was shooting a home movie, but then suddenly was overcome by the beauty and significance of the place. It was a truly spiritual moment.
Oh, wow.
So overwhelming, I had to stop filming. It may seem strange, but I'd never felt connected to my faith until that point. It was no longer a place I had to visit. It was a place I needed to visit.
Violent clashes have broken out.
I'm a presenter. I'm not a baptized Sikh, which means that I cut my hair and don't adhere to the religious dress code.
He's a martial artist.
But since that visit to the Golden Temple, I've wanted to learn more about the faith I was born into. Sonia Diol is in fact a stage name. I was born Jaswinder Kaur Sidhu. But going to a predominantly white school in Birmingham in the 80s, I remember feeling embarrassed by my traditional Punjabi sounding name. I was more into pop music and fashion than the momentous news stories of the time, and quite a challenge for my mum and dad.
What was I like as a little girl?
Very cute. Very sweet. But a little cheeky as well.
Did you remember this one? This picture?
This is going to the Gurdwara, I think.
Yeah. I mean, mum, you used to make me wear some really dodgy Indian suits. I can't believe you made me wear that.
But we always think if you try to wear English clothes, you might be an English girl. If you put Indian clothes, suit,
yeah,
take you to the temple, you might be changed to the...
Into an Indian,
yes. Yes.
I may not have become quite the traditional Indian girl my mum dreamed of, but as I've got older, I do now take my faith more seriously. And I regularly go to a Sikh temple or Gurdwara.
This is my local place of worship. It's the Soho Road Gurdwara in Birmingham, and it's always busy. Lots of families coming here every day to worship. And the first thing you do when you come into a Sikh temple is to remove your shoes.
Sikhs are followers of 10 enlightened leaders called gurus. The first, Guru Nanak, taught that there is only one God and that men and women are equal. He stressed the importance of service to the wider community, so each Gurdwara has a free kitchen that anyone can enjoy. I've even seen Irish builders having their lunch break in here. The focus of any Gurdwara is the Holy Scriptures, or Guru Granth Sahib. We believe that this is not a book, but the definitive words of the gurus. I know I'm biased, but my experience is that Sikhs work hard, often unnoticed, for whatever community they're part of. That's why these scenes from 1984 are so shocking.
The whole of the front of it has been knocked out. There's rubble piled everywhere. You can only go into one.
Because the Golden Temple is the symbol of Sikhism, millions around the world saw the army action quite simply as an assault on their faith. I don't understand why this attack took place and the tragic events that followed afterwards. For me, I think this journey is going to be an emotional one, at times a painful one, and I know it's going to teach me something about my own identity as a Sikh and how I'm going to cope with that. I don't know. For me, this isn't a news assignment. It's a personal journey. And it begins in the Punjab, in the northwest of India. This is where my family are from. And although I've only been here a few times, it feels good to be back. This isn't going to make sense to some people. I was born and brought up in England, and yet I feel such a sense of connection and a real sense of belonging every time I come here. Just looking out, it's a really warm feeling. I feel very blessed to have two cultures that I take so much from. To understand the events of 1984, I need to find out more about the man at the heart of the story, Jarnail Singh Bhindranwale. He was born in a violent year, 1947, the year of partition, when the Punjab was divided between India and the new nation of Pakistan. At the age of 13, Jarnail Singh was sent to a religious school in the Punjab countryside, and it was there that a dramatic transformation took place. I'm off now to the school to find out why this young boy turned into such a fiery, inspirational leader. The school, called the Damdami Taksal, is a deeply religious place. So I've changed out of my Western clothes into a traditional Punjabi outfit. I must admit to feeling rather nervous about being here. This is a strict male-dominated community, and they may not approve of a Sikh woman with cut hair like mine. The Taksal is the place to go if you want to become a priest or preacher. The boys have a strict daily regime of prayer, exercise, but most important of all, learning the scriptures by heart. Sajit Singh Sudi was a teacher at the Taksal when Bhindranwale joined in the mid-1960s.
Tusi mainu dasso Bhindranwale ki dooje bachiyan to vakhre lagde si thonu?
Lagde si. Oh shant rehnde sige te bani padde rehnde sige jyada dooje bachiyan nu bani vadh padde sige. ਤੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਧਰਮ ਬਾਰੇ ਉਹ ਕਿਸੇ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਬਰਦਾਸ਼ਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਕਰਦੇ ਜੇ ਕੋਈ ਧਰਮ ਤੋਂ ਉਲਟ ਗੱਲ ਕਰੇ ਨਾ ਉਹ ਬਰਦਾਸ਼ਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਕਰਦੇ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਉਹ ਗੁੱਸੇ ਨਾਲ ਵੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਵੀ ਜੇ ਕੁਛ ਕੁ ਨਾਰਾਜ਼ਗੀ ਨਾਲ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਸਮਝਦਾ ਫਿਰ ਉਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਬੋਲਣਾ ਛੱਡ ਦਿੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਬੈਠਣਾ ਉੱਠਣਾ ਬੋਲਣਾ ਚੱਲਣਾ ਛੱਡ ਦਿੰਦੇ ਸੀ
ਹਾਂਜੀ
Bhindranwale was clearly a passionate student whose determination and devotion would mean that in 1977, aged only 30, he would become head of the Taksal. The boys today have more modest ambitions. The Taksal has posed more questions than given answers. The Bhindranwale I heard about was someone who, if he disagreed with your religious views, would at worst just ignore you.
We obviously know that there was more to him than that, and I have to find out what it was that changed him.
The answer has to lie in the politics of the time. The leading Sikh party were the Akali Dal, who campaigned for greater autonomy for the Punjab. Lined up against them were the Congress party, dominated by Indira Gandhi and her son Sanjay. Congress had always advocated a secular, united India, and the Gandhis feared that the Akali call for greater autonomy in fact meant a separate Sikh religious state. In 1977, Indira Gandhi asked Sanjay to find a way to break the Akali Dal influence in the Punjab. Sanjay looked for someone who could set up a rival faction. Of the list of 20 names he was given, the new leader of the Taksal clearly had the greatest potential. Bhindranwale had become well known for urging village Sikhs to abstain from drink and drugs and not cut their hair. His Back to Sikh Basics campaign touched a nerve, and he was baptising young men and women in their hundreds. My guide to the complicated world of Indian politics is Sir Mark Tully, who for 22 years was the BBC's chief correspondent in India. Throughout 1984, his reports were a lifeline for British Indians anxious for news.
Bhindranwale was chosen in part because of his extreme religious views and because it was thought that compared with the rather tired, elderly leaders of the Akali Dal, compromised in various ways, here was a young guy who was, in fact, a devout and practicing Sikh. And it must have been very tempting to him because obviously what the Congress were telling him was, you come along with us and we'll make you the ruler of Punjab, in effect, really.
So Congress needed someone to sing their tune?
Who could, I think, be made to sing their tune might be a better way of putting it, someone who could be groomed. And really it was more to take a stand against the Akalis than to sing the Congress tune.
Do you think Bhindranwale was a natural politician?
No, he wasn't really a natural politician. He was much more a natural, fanatical, religious leader than a natural politician.
Mark met Bhindranwale on a number of occasions and found him to be an intimidating man.
I remember one thing which happened to me when I was at a press conference, and being a bit of a fidgety sort of person, my foot almost, because we were all sitting on the floor, of course, almost touched his sword. And then Bhindranwale looked at me, and I really almost thought to myself, God, this sword's going to be used on me for this. He was a frightening figure, there's no doubt about that.
Bhindranwale generates strong feelings. What some saw as frightening, others saw as inspiring. They believed he was merely upholding Sikh rights and fighting heresy. Some even hoped he'd bring about their dream of a Sikh state called Khalistan. But in the early 80s, Bhindranwale and his followers were repeatedly accused of intimidating and murdering their opponents. In September 1982, the owner of a newspaper chain critical of Bhindranwale was shot dead. Bhindranwale was suspected of masterminding the killing and arrested. What happened next was a turning point. Court proceedings began, but then, to the surprise of many, he was released without charge. The government had arranged Bhindranwale's freedom, believing he was more used to them out of prison, campaigning against the Akali Dal party. He celebrated with a triumphant drive around Delhi. Bhindranwale was seen as a hero who had stood up to the government and won. He may have felt that he could now achieve greater support opposing the government than working with them. Mark Tully has his own theory why Bhindranwale turned against his Congress allies. During the raid to arrest Bhindranwale, the police accidentally or deliberately destroyed his most precious possessions.
During the arrest, the police managed to burn every sermon that Bhindranwale had ever preached, because Bhindranwale had a secretary who used to write down every sermon that he preached. And thereafter, Bhindranwale would frequently, when attacking the government, say, "What can you say about someone who kills your children?" His children being his sermons. And this really does seem to have been something which went into him very sharply.
In June 1982, Bhindranwale and a group of his followers moved into part of the Golden Temple complex. His critics said he wanted sanctuary to avoid another arrest. His supporters that he wished to be close to the spiritual centre of his faith. For me, the emotions I feel as I get close to the Golden Temple are hard to describe. There's a strong sense of excitement because it's here that I feel at peace with God. This is the place that makes me feel more connected to my faith than anywhere else in the world.
is the Golden Temple, or Darbar Sahib as Sikhs know it. The reason that this place is so special is because there are the holy scriptures, the Guru Granth Sahib, and that's where pilgrims pay their respects in their thousands every day.
The temple has a doorway on each side. That's to symbolise access to all, even other faiths. One of the first things I always do at the Golden Temple is to recite prayers from the holy scriptures. Although I'm surrounded by thousands of pilgrims, nothing distracts me. So how was this peace shattered? How did the 1984 attack happen? In the early 80s, the Punjab was caught in a spiral of violence, provoked mainly, it's alleged, by Bhindranwale's supporters stirring up communal hatred in their fight against the Hindu Raj. Sikhs and Hindus desecrated each other's temples. Buses were hijacked and the Hindu passengers separated from Sikhs and then shot. When the police searched for militants, they were often what they termed encounters, but what others called the killings of Sikhs. This merely strengthened Bhindranwale's cause. Meanwhile, his status grew. Pilgrims to Amritsar were leaving their offerings at Bhindranwale's feet rather than at the Golden Temple. Children were brought to him to be blessed. In November 1983, in a deeply symbolic move, he transferred his headquarters into the Akal Takht, the centre of Sikh political power. As far as the government was concerned, Bhindranwale was out of control. Rajiv Gandhi, now the rising star of the Congress Party after the death of his brother Sanjay, called for him to be expelled from the Golden Temple. "Tell him to come and try," was Bindranwale's reply. It was clear to journalists who visited the Akal Takht that Bhindranwale was getting ready for a fight.
The scene was now set for a terrible and final showdown.
On the 1st of June, a Sikh officer named Major General Brar arrived in Amritsar to coordinate the army plans to capture Bhindranwale. Still hopeful that some sort of settlement could be reached, Indira Gandhi made an appeal on the 2nd of June to the people of the Punjab. "Don't shed blood," she said, "shed hatred." It failed. The army received the order to proceed. As tanks and troops enclosed the complex, Brar instructed his soldiers not to fire on the Golden Temple or the Akal Takht without direct orders. A curfew was imposed and all journalists expelled from the city. The operation, codenamed Bluestar, had begun.
"It's quite clear to me that a siege of the temple has started."
General Brar sent his commandos down these steps to start the assault on Bhindranwale and his men. But they were mown down by gunmen that were hiding on both sides of the walls. He then sent in a second wave of commandos, and this time they were successful. They got down the steps, but they faced fire from not only the buildings around here, but from underground as well.
Bindrawali's men suddenly appeared from manhole covers, firing their machine guns and then disappearing into the complex's many underground passages. The army had clearly underestimated their opponents. Gyanipur and Singh was a priest at the Golden Temple. He and the other priests weren't going to allow 500 years of prayer to be interrupted, not even by a full-scale battle. This makes him a key eyewitness to Operation Blue Star. He was in the Akal Takht when he saw Bhindranwale in action.
ਜੇ ਉਸ ਵੇਲੇ ਯੁੱਧ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਪਿਆ ਸੀ ਤੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਹੱਥ ਨਾਲ ਉਹ ਮੇਖ ਜੀਨ ਭਰਦੇ ਸਨ ਤੇ ਭਰ ਭਰ ਕੇ ਢੇਰ ਲਾਈ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਤਾਂ ਰੰਚਕ ਮਾਤਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਚਿਹਰੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਉਦਾਸੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਪਿਓ ਪਤਾ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਮਨੁੱਖ ਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਮੇਰਾ ਕਰਕੇ ਜੋ ਕੁਝ ਇਹ ਢਹਿ ਢੇਰੀ ਹੋ ਰਿਹਾ, ਦੁਨੀਆਂ ਮਰ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਮੇਰਾ ਕਰਕੇ, ਇਕੱਲੇ ਦੇ ਕਰਕੇ। ਪਰ ਉਹਦੇ ਮਨ ਤੇ ਕੋਈ ਅਸਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ, ਰੰਚਕ ਮਾਤਰ ਵੀ ਤੇ ਉਹ ਹੱਸਦੇ ਸਨ।
With losses mounting and the operation dragging on dangerously, the army faced another problem. An armoured personnel carrier sent in to get troops to the Agaltakht was hit by a rocket-propelled grenade. The army had no idea that Bhindranwale was so well equipped. General Bra decided on a dramatic new plan. He ordered tanks into the complex through this entrance.
ਇਹ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਹੈ ਇਹ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਪਲੇਨ ਹੋ ਚੁੱਕੀ ਸੀ।
ਅੱਛਾ,
ਹਾਂ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ, ਪੱਥਰ ਪੁੱਥਰ ਸਭ ਮਲ ਦਿੱਤੇ ਸਨ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਤੇ ਪਲੇਨ ਹੋਈ। ਆਥਣੀ ਵੱਡੇ ਟੈਂਕ ਇੱਧਰ ਦੀ ਉਤਰਿਆ ਤੇ ਉਹ ਬਖਤਰ ਬੰਦ ਗੱਡੀ ਉਥਣੀ ਆਈ ਸੀ
ਤਾਂ ਟੈਂਕ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਦੇਖਿਓ ਸੀ?
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਹਾਂਜੀ, ਆਹ ਸਾਰੇ ਉਤਰ ਕੇ ਆਏ ਦੀ ਆਏ ਥੱਲੇ, ਬਾਕੀ ਫਿਰ ਸਾਰੇ ਚਾਰ ਫੇਰੇ ਸਨ। ਇਹ ਤਾਂ ਪਰਮੇਸ਼ਰ ਨੂੰ ਹੀ ਪਤਾ ਇਹਦੇ ਬਾਅਦ, ਅਸੀਂ ਕਿੱਥੋਂ ਸੋਚਣਾ ਸੀ ਵੀ ਟੈਂਕ ਆਉਣਗੇ ਪਰਕਰਮਾ 'ਚ।
The Agaltakht was all but destroyed in the tank barrage. It's believed that Bhindranwale was shot as he and other militants ran from the front of the building.
At the height of the battle, there were 3 hours of hand-to-hand fighting. Battle at the Golden Temple has been hard-fought and costly.
The government estimated that about 100 soldiers and 200 of Bhindranwale's men died during Operation Bluestar. Bhindranwale's body was hastily photographed and then cremated with the rest of the dead militants. 2 days after the operation ended, there were still pockets of resistance, as Major General Bra discovered as he gave an interview claiming that Bhindranwale had received assistance from abroad.
From some of the weapons that we've captured, we can see clearly the identification We can clearly establish that these weapons have been obtained from China or Pakistan.
But there's another side to Operation Blue Star. It's the story of those caught in the crossfire. When the attack happened, these men, all from the same village, were in the temple complex along with their families and hundreds of other pilgrims to celebrate the anniversary of the martyrdom of the temple's founder. In the early hours of the 6th of June, these men claim the army stormed their hostel looking for Bhindranwale's men.
Grenade hit saade kamre jaan se sheeshe vich di
sheeshe vich grenade
jehde je bande samajh lai paye di oh theek rahe jehda banda baitha di uncha di
bachcha di paune 2 saal da
dudh chungna di
matlab dudh chungaundi si jadon dudh chungda chungda te ohda grenade na sara paad gaya matta itta gal utt gaya pare
tade samne
haan samne bichale baithe saade ਇੱਕ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਮੰਮੀ ਸੀ, ਇੱਕ ਮੇਰੇ ਘਰ ਵਾਲੀ ਸੀ, ਇੱਕ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਗੁੱਡੀ ਸੀ ਤੇ ਇੱਕ ਬੰਦਾ ਅੰਮ੍ਰਿਤਸਰ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਦਾ ਇਸੇ ਜ਼ਿਲ੍ਹੇ ਦਾ ਸੀ। ਉਹ ਚਾਰੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਮਤਲਬ ਮੌਕੇ ਤੇ ਮੌਤ ਹੋ ਗਏ।
ਆਹ ਗੋਲੀ ਲੱਗੀ, ਆਹ ਗ੍ਰਨੇਡ ਦੇ ਟੁਕੜੇ ਵੱਜੇ ਇੱਧਰ ਦੇ, ਇਹ ਵੱਜਿਆ, ਆਹ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਟੁਕੜੇ, ਆਹ ਥੋੜੇ 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 ਟੁਕੜੇ, ਆ ਇੱਥੋਂ ਦੇ, ਆਹ ਸਾਰੇ 24 ਰੋਣੇ ਵੱਜੇ ਜੀ ਬੱਚੇ ਦੇ।
ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਖਬਰ ਮਿਲੀ ਸੀ ਆਰਮੀ ਵੱਲੋਂ ਕਿ ਸੰਗਤ ਨਿਕਲ ਜਾਵੇ?
ਨਹੀਂ, ਕੋਈ ਖਬਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲੀ ਸਾਨੂੰ। ਖਬਰ ਤਾਂ ਜੇ ਮਤਲਬ ਮਿਲਦੀ ਉੱਥੇ ਮਰਨ ਨੂੰ ਕਿਹਦਾ ਜੀ ਕਰਦਾ ਪਿਆ ਸੀ, ਇੱਥੇ ਮਰਜੀ ਆ।
ਜਿਹੜੇ ਆਰਮੀ ਵਾਲੇ ਆ ਜਨਰਲ ਬਰਾਡ, ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਆ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਅਟੈਕ ਕਰਨਾ ਪਿਆ ਸੀ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਅੰਦਰ ਅੱਤਵਾਦੀ ਸੀ।
ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕੀ ਸੋਚਦੇ ਸੀ, ਨਾ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਅਸੀਂ ਅੱਤਵਾਦੀ ਦੇਖਿਆ ਕੋਈ, ਨਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਭਿੰਡਰਾਲਾ ਦੇਖਿਆ, ਨਾ ਇਹਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਹੁਣ ਅਸੀਂ ਕੁਛ ਕੀ ਕਹਿ ਸਕਦੇ।
ਅਸੀਂ
ਆਪਦੀਆਂ ਜਾਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਸਿਰ ਬਣੀ ਦੀ ਵੀ ਆਪਦੀ ਜਾਨ ਬਚ,
ਜਿਹੜੀ ਜਨਤਾ ਦਾ ਨੁਕਸਾਨ ਕਰਿਆ ਇਹ ਇਕੱਲੇ ਭਿੰਡਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਖਾਤਰ, ਫਿਰ ਇੰਨੀ ਪਾਬਲਿਕ ਦਾ ਤਾਂ ਕੋਈ ਫਾਇਦਾ ਅਸਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੀ।
It's hard to get any accurate figures of how many pilgrims died. Maybe it's better not to know. This has been a hard day, talking to the eyewitnesses and picturing the battle in this sacred place. But now I need to hear an account of Operation Blue Star from a very different perspective. I'm waiting for the man who's at the heart of this story, Major General Bra. Because of the controversial decisions he took, he's needed police protection for over 25 years. We've had to keep the details of our meeting secret. I've done many interviews in my career, but none have felt quite so personal. First, I want to know how he copes with the constant threats to his life.
It doesn't feel good, but what can you do about it? I got a call from my son who was in America some years ago, 2 years ago, to say that please go onto the net and open up a site. And there, as you open the website, they said, our number one enemy of the Sikhs today is General Kuldeep Singh Brar. There have been 6 assassination attempts on his life, which have not succeeded, but the 7th one will. So those of you who are in favor of joining in for this, click here.
Are you scared?
I'm not scared.
There must be some fear. You're under constant protection.
It's in your psychology. It's at the back of your mind. That's about it.
The timing of Operation Blue Star outraged many Sikhs. It was launched during an important religious festival. The complex was full of pilgrims like those I met. Many were killed. Why did the army go in at such a sensitive time?
The orders given were, please go in as soon as possible because things have gone to a very serious state. Bhindranwale is in total command of the situation. And the longer we allow this to happen, the more difficult it will be later on to curb it. It has nothing to do with any religious sentiments. And the question is that if pilgrims were inside, we lifted the curfew on the third night to allow them to come out, those who wanted to come out. Many came out.
But what about the eyewitnesses that said they didn't hear any of the announcements?
That's not true. I mean, there were loudspeakers blaring away all the time. But the fact is, it's very difficult to distinguish in the middle of the night who's a civilian and who's a militant. The firing is coming and the firing is being returned. And in crossfire, some civilians die and some militants die. It's not easy to differentiate.
Why go in when you know there are pilgrims inside?
How long do you wait? You wait the next day, we won't be able to go in.
But where could Bhindranwale have gone if you had pretty much the whole place surrounded?
No, it was not only a question of having the whole place surrounded. We would get surrounded in the next 24 hours. After all, how long can you keep this away from this news from traveling to the hinterland of Punjab? You'd have had thousands and millions of Sikhs with spears, guns, everything rushing to Amritsar. And that would be a very sad situation for a man in uniform.
So you went in at that point for the safety of your own army?
Not only the safety of our army, we had to accomplish the task. If we don't go in, forget the safety of the army, the task isn't going to get accomplished.
But what about your responsibility to make moral decisions? This is the holiest, this is the centre of the Sikh faith.
But I'm very sad to tell you that it was no longer holy and sacrosanct. So if you're saying that morally we should have thought differently, what about those people who were inside? Was there any sanctity left inside the Golden Temple? Where's the morality of the people who were building bunkers in there and storing ammunition? I'm sorry, I have to disagree with you.
What do you say to those people who see Bhindranwale as a saint, actually, and not a terrorist?
He may have started as a saint, but he didn't end as a saint, let me tell you that. There was nothing saintliness about him at the time of Operation Blue Star.
In the chaos of battle, the Golden Temple was hit and the sacred scriptures, the Guru Granth Sahib, were struck by a bullet. The Akal Takht all but destroyed. Did he accept any responsibility for the damage done?
The responsibility is collective for whatever damage did take place. But the point is, the damage could have been much more severe. But the army held back their weapons at that stage. Wasn't Bhindranwale, and being such a religious man, concerned about the damage that could have been caused to the complex by sticking out and fighting and opening fire from all directions?
25 years on, do you now have any remorse or any regret about what happened?
On the actions that I was asked to carry out, I was quite convinced that they were legitimate orders given and they had to be done. The remorse and sorrow is there for those human beings who lost their lives. One feels sorry for them. One doesn't only feel sorry for the innocent people who've lost their lives, but even those who are not innocent who lost their lives, those who were the militants there, because after all, they have families also. And don't ever think that those who were involved in this operation didn't feel remorse or pity or sadness or sorrow. They did for whatever happened. No one likes to kill. No one likes to destroy. No one likes to hurt.
What impact has this had on you personally?
It is an enormous impact. Once you put on your uniform, you have to accept these things. You have to accept the fact that there will be ups and there will be downs.
But was this a price worth paying?
I don't know. I really don't know.
General Brar is clearly critical of Bhindranwale. In fact, I did meet other Sikhs who felt Bhindranwale should not have been in the Golden Temple complex in the first place, but they weren't prepared to say that on camera. Bhindranwale still has passionate supporters who see him as a martyr and are unhappy with any criticism of their dead leader. Close to the Golden Temple, I came across a bookstall selling all kinds of Bhindranwale memorabilia.
What does it say on the back of his T-shirt there?
It's written Bhindranwale Babbar Shera.
How old are you?
I'm 18.
18. And is Bhindranwale a hero for you?
Yeah. He was a great saint and great soldier.
How are you connecting with what he says?
By reading books, by listening from other people. So, you are Indian?
I'm Indian, yes.
You believe in Mahatma Gandhi? You were not at the time of Mahatma Gandhi, but you say that he is the father of nation. Why? By listening, by reading books. So same with me.
As a Sikh boy today, is anyone attacking your faith?
Attacking? Not personally, but in schools people attack.
But you personally haven't seen anything yourself?
Although Satnam feels a sense of injustice, he's clearly struggling to find any evidence to back it up. I'm encouraged that things have changed a great deal since 1984.
Swords of protest in London. The Sikhs show their anger over Amritsar.
The assault on the Golden Temple stunned India and the world. In Britain, there were large demonstrations denouncing Mrs. Gandhi.
Several effigies of the Indian Prime Minister attracted the full force of the demonstrators' fury.
A community that had been almost invisible was suddenly on the streets and making headlines. I have vague memories of seeing these scenes as an 11-year-old. Then they confused me. Now I understand them. In Amritsar, the military action may have ended, but the tragic story of 1984 was far from over.
A few weeks after Operation Bluestar, a policeman called Beyant Singh brought his family to the Golden Temple, and he was so shocked by what he saw that he became withdrawn and more devout. The significance of this is that Beyant Singh was Indira Gandhi's personal bodyguard.
Beyant Singh had travelled with the Prime Minister around the world and was one of the most trusted members of her security team. But the events of June so outraged him that he began to plan Indira Gandhi's assassination. Although his superiors knew nothing of the plot, they were still nervous about having Sikhs so close to the Prime Minister, so they were moved from her protection team. Mrs. Gandhi strongly opposed the change, and so Sikh guards remained on duty.
Do you now fear for your own personal safety?
Well, I've lived with danger all my life, and I think I've had a pretty full life, and it makes no difference whether you die in bed or you die standing up.
On the morning of the 31st of October, Indira Gandhi left her home in Delhi to take part in a TV interview. As she walked along the path, she saw Beyant Singh on duty and smiled. He drew his revolver and fired five shots at close range. An accomplice, Satwant Singh, opened fire with a machine gun. Mrs. Gandhi spun round from the impact and crumpled to the floor.
We regret to announce the death of the Prime Minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi.
Beyant Singh was shot dead on the spot, and his accomplice, Satwant Singh, wounded. He was later tried and executed. I'm confused about Indira Gandhi. It could be argued that Operation Blue Star showed she had little regard for the Sikh faith, and yet she retained her Sikh bodyguards against advice.
But at present you hold no political office.
Mark Talley knew Mrs. Gandhi well, having interviewed her many times. How did he explain her decision to keep her bodyguards?
Well, I think this was Indira Gandhi wanting desperately to show that she was not an enemy of the Sikh community and wanting very much to do whatever she could to calm the thing down again after Operation Blue Star.
But can you understand why some people see Indira Gandhi's action as an attack on the Sikh faith?
Yes, of course, I can understand the deep sorrow, horror of Sikhs. I mean, I know that if someone came and started firing at St. Paul's Cathedral in London, I know the way that I would feel. But I do think that also Sikhs should realise that mistakes were made on both sides and that there was a great deal of violence going on, violence done by Bhindranwale's men.
In 1948, when Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated, India was stunned. But the fact that the killer was one of their own meant there wasn't a violent reaction from Hindus. But in 1984, when the news quickly emerged that Indira Gandhi's killers were Sikh, the world held its breath. How would Hindus now respond?
As Mrs. Gandhi lay dead in a Delhi hospital, a married couple called Gurmej Singh and Mahinder Kaur set off by train from the Punjab with their baby daughter to start a new life in Mumbai. They carried with them all their possessions and ambitious hopes for the future. They had no idea that Mrs. Gandhi had been assassinated and were heading straight for trouble.
Train te jadon tusi chadhe si bahut khush hone tusi
bahut khush sige utthe amritsar sanu sade rishtedar vi mil gaye bade khush khush assi ki rail de vich baithe ਤੇ ਰਸਤੇ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਦੇਸ਼ ਪਲਟ ਗਿਆ
ਆ ਫੋਟੋ
ਆ ਮੇਰਾ ਸਫੈਂਡ
ਟ੍ਰੇਨ ਤੋਂ ਚੜ੍ਹਨ ਤੇ
ਇੱਕ ਦਿਨ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ 31 ਅਕਤੂਬਰ ਨੂੰ ਖਿੱਚੀ ਗਈ ਸੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਹੀ ਚੰਗੇ ਸੀ ਹਸਬੈਂਡ ਮੇਰੇ ਮੈਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਸਿਫਤ ਕਰ ਹੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਦੀ ਕਿ ਇੰਨਾ ਚੰਗੇ ਲੱਗਦੇ ਸੀ ਮੈਨੂੰ
After 7 hours, the train stopped at a station outside Delhi. Suddenly, a mob surrounded them and surged into the carriage.
Phallo phallo la 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 karti.
Ki kende oh ki kende si?
Bhi sikhan ne saadi maa maarti hai khoon da badla khoon. Innan ne pagdi vaddi sige sikh sige. Te seat te bas baithyan de unnan ne sariya mare sir ch khoon vagan lag gaya. ਸਿਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਖੂਨ ਜਾਣ ਲੱਗ ਗਿਆ ਕਹਿੰਦਾ ਵੀ ਮੈਂ ਤੇ ਮਹਿੰਦਰ ਕੋਲ ਹੁਣ ਤੇਰੇ ਨਾਲ ਕੋਈ ਘਰ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀਤੀ ਤੇ ਪਰ ਬਚਣਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੈਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਵੜ ਕੇ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਆਪਣੀ ਸੀਟਾਂ ਨੇ ਗੱਡੀ ਦੀ ਸੀਟ ਦੇ ਥੱਲੇ ਲੰਮਾ ਪਾਇਆ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਬਾਅਦ 'ਚ ਫਿਰ ਸਮਾਨ ਲੁੱਟਣ ਆਏ ਆ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਫਿਰ ਲੈ ਗਏ ਸਾਡੇ ਕੋਲ ਖੋਹ ਕੇ ਲੈ ਗਏ ਅਸੀਂ ਖੋਹਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਰੋਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਖਪਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਖੋਹਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਦੇਣਾ
One Sikh mother in Mahinder's carriage saved her son's life by quickly tying his long hair into plaits so the mob would think that he was a girl. But the mob were not fooled by Mahinder's attempts to hide Gurmej between the seats. They dragged him onto the platform.
ਪਤਾ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਕਹਿਣ ਲੱਗਿਆ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਫੋਟੋ ਤਾਂ ਮੜਾਉਣੀ ਆ ਜੇ ਫੋਟੋ ਸੋਹਣੀ ਆਏਗੀ ਤੇ ਮੈਂ ਆ ਕੇ ਮੈਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਚ ਜੱਜਮੈਂਟ ਕਰੂੰਗਾ ਫੋਟੋ ਆਪਾਂ ਤੇ ਜੇ ਫੋਟੋ ਸੋਹਣੀ ਆਈ ਤੇ ਫਿਰ ਮੜਾਉਣੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਤੇ ਮੜਾਉਣੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦਾ ਬਚਨ ਸੀ ਫਿਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇਖੀ ਨੀ ਮੈਂ ਮੜਾਈ ਨੀ
ਇਟਸ ਬੀਨ ਅ ਡਿਫੀਕਲਟ ਟਾਈਮ ਫਾਰ ਮਹਿੰਦਰ Since 1984, she's raised her daughter alone. But recently, after a long battle, she received some compensation from the government for Gurmej's death, and her daughter is now married. At last, joy has come into Mahinder's life.
Can you just tell us where we're going?
To try and understand how the terrible violence began, I'm with Ashok Vahi, a news photographer based in New Delhi. In 1984, he was at the hospital where Indira Gandhi was taken to get shots of the crowd outside. But then he came across a very different story.
Firstly, it was not allowed to go inside the hospital. Then one of the hospital security has come. He knows me. Mm-hmm. Then he said, hey, listen, you can have a very good picture that some of the sick boys, young boys, are inside the casualty. Emergency. I went inside. Immediately I made my camera and took one, two shot.
What Ashok had discovered was a group of terrified young men, beaten and robbed of their turbans. News had got out that Mrs. Gandhi's killers were Sikhs, and a mob was out for revenge.
Is that blood on his shirt?
Yeah, that is blood. Now you can see their faces. Mm-hmm. See this boy, see their eyes, how they feel. Mm-hmm. If we go out, huge crowd is there, they will be again attacked by public.
As the rioting spread across Delhi, a friend who just arrived by train from the Punjab called Ashok and told him to get to the station as soon as possible. What Ashok saw there appalled him. No longer just beating, the mobs were now killing. The picture he took was printed in newspapers around the world.
I've just spoken, Ashok, to a woman who lost her husband on a train coming in from Punjab. Her husband was dragged from the train.
Yeah.
This could be the train.
Yeah.
As a Hindu?
Yeah.
Seeing all of this happening for the first time in your life?
Yeah, that is the first time in my life.
How did that make you feel?
I feel... And I pray this will not happen again anymore in this country.
But then Ashok went from observing the drama to being part of it. On the evening of the 1st of November, a Sikh friend called Narinder Singh Bernala came to Ashok, too terrified to go home. He realised that the only option was to hide his friend in his tiny dark room.
In the night, we put some... newspapers.
You just put some newspapers for him to sleep on?
Yeah. It's very small, but whether it is a big or whether it is a small, we have to manage, we have to save his life.
So how long did you keep him in this very tiny space for?
2 days.
Did you have any moments where you nearly got caught out?
Yeah, it was one or two times there was a chances when the mob came outside my office and they are trying to burn a one Sikh shop here.
What would have happened if somebody had found out?
Can be shot dead. He can be beaten like anything. Because people are very scared.
So standing in this space after 25 years,
yeah.
How does it make you feel talking about
it? I feel proud of me that I have saved one life. I have saved my friend's life. I'm proud of me.
I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
You.
Thankfully, Ashok was one of many Hindus whose first thought was to protect Sikh friends and neighbours.
The attacks didn't just happen in central Delhi where Ashok was. The mobs wanted to kill in greater numbers, so they headed to the outskirts of Delhi, areas like Trilokpuri and Mongolpuri. That's where the Sikh communities lived.
Almost every family has a story of murder, burning and beating.
He was burned alive in the garage along with the car.
At their local Gurdwara, I met three men who'd all lost loved ones. Inside is a painting depicting the horrors of the mob violence. The local Sikh community had described their ordeal to a painter and slowly a macabre picture was created.
ਇਹ ਦੇਖੋ ਜੀ ਅੱਗ ਲਾਈ ਹੋਈ ਹੈ ਇਹ ਕੋਈ ਮਤਲਬ ਗੋਲੀ ਨਾਲ ਮਾਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਮਤਲਬ ਜ਼ੁਲਮ ਹੋਇਆ ਮਤਲਬ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੂੰ ਗਲੇ 'ਚ ਟਾਇਰ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਤੇ ਮਾਰਿਆ ਗਿਆ ਹੈ ਕਿਸੇ ਤੇ ਪੈਟਰੋਲ ਛਿੜਕ ਕੇ ਮਾਰਿਆ ਗਿਆ ਹੈ
The men's story is made worse by the fact that they alleged that the riots were no disorganized rampage
ਜੋ ਪੁਲਿਸ ਸੀ ਉਹਨੇ ਆ ਕੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਧਮਕਾਇਆ ਕਿ ਜਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਘਰਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਚਲੇ ਜਾਓ ਨਹੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਫਿਰ ਅਸੀਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਮਾਰਾਂਗੇ ਜੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਘਰ ਚਲੇ ਜਾਓਗੇ ਤੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਤੁਹਾਡੀ ਰੱਖਿਆ ਕਰਾਂਗੇ ਤੇ ਹਰ ਬੰਦਾ ਆਪਣੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਘਰ ਪਰ ਚਲਾ ਗਿਆ ਉਸ ਦਿਨ ਫਿਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਗੁਰਦੁਆਰਾ ਸਾੜਿਆ ਸਭ ਤੋਂ ਪਹਿਲੇ ਗੁਰਦੁਆਰੇ ਸਾੜ ਕੇ ਪਰ ਜਿਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਪਤਾ ਲੱਗਿਆ ਵੀ ਘਰਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਸੀਂ ਵੜ ਗਏ ਹਾਂ ਤੇ ਫਿਰ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਬੰਦੇ ਛੱਡ ਦਿੱਤੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਹਰ ਘਰ ਤੇ ਕਿਸੇ 100 ਕਿਸੇ 200 ਕਿਸੇ 50 ਬੰਦਾ
ਸਮਝੇ ਨਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਕਿਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਹੀ ਕੱਪੜੇ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਜਨਾਨੀਆਂ ਦੇ ਕੱਪੜੇ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਤੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਕਿਸੇ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਜਨਾਨੀਆਂ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਲੁਕਾ ਕੇ ਤੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਘਰੋਂ ਕੱਢਤਾ ਤੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਬਾਹਰ ਚਲੇ ਗਏ ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਜੋ ਕੁਛ ਹੋਇਆ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਬੀਬੀਆਂ ਨਾਲ ਵਿਧਵਾਵਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਜਿਸ ਟਾਈਮ ਵਿਧਵਾ ਪ੍ਰੈਜ਼ੈਂਟ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਸਾਰੀ ਅੱਖਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਵੇਖਿਆ ਸੀ ਇਹਨੂੰ ਗੱਲੇ 'ਚ
ਦੀਸ 3 ਮੈਨ ਹੈਡ ਐਨ ਐਕਸਟ੍ਰਾਰਡਨਰੀ ਐਸਕੇਪ ਇਟਸ ਐਸਟੀਮੇਟਿਡ ਦੈਟ ਅਬਾਊਟ 3000 ਸਿੱਖਸ ਵਰ ਕਿਲਡ ਇਨ ਦਿੱਲੀ ਅਲੋਨ 50,000 ਫਲੈਡ ਦ ਸਿਟੀ It's chilling to think that the violence may have been made worse by those that should have protected them. The human cost of the barbarity can be found in these block of flats. Here, women who lost husbands and sons were resettled in what's become known as the widow's colony. For them, what they saw just over 25 years ago is still raw and deeply painful.
ਇਨ ਬੇਟੇ ਮਾਰ ਦੀਏ ਫਿਰ ਵਾਲਾ ਮਾਰ ਦਿਆ ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਮਰ ਗਿਆ ਮਰ ਘਰ ਮੇ ਮਰ ਤੋ ਨਾ ਰਿਹਾ ਨਾ
ਆਪ ਬਤਾਏ ਆਪਕੇ ਪਰਿਵਾਰ ਪਰ ਕਿਆ ਬੀਤੀ ਗਏ ਕਿਆ ਹੋਆ ਥਾ
ਮੇਰੇ ਚਾਰ ਲੜਕੇ ਚਾਰ ਲੜਕੋ ਕੋ ਮੇਰੇ ਕੋ ਜਲਾ ਦਿਆ ਮਿੱਟੀ ਕਾ ਤੇਲ ਦੁਨੀਆਂ ਕੇ ਕਮਰੇ ਮੇ ਨਿਕਲਤੇ ਰਹੇ ਉਹ ਗੇਰ ਗੇਰ ਕੇ ਜਲਾਤੇ ਰਹੇ ਟੈਰ ਵੀ ਲਗਾ ਦਿਆ ਬੀਚ ਮੇ ਦੋਨੋ ਗਏ ਔਰ ਆਗ ਲਗਾ ਦੀ ਹਾਏ ਮੰਮੀ ਹਾਏ ਪਾਪਾ ਹਾਏ ਮੰਮੀ ਹਾਏ ਪਾਪਾ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਔਰ ਹਮ ਉਧਰ ਰੋ ਰਹੇ
ਆਪਨੇ ਦੇਖਾ ਆਪਨੇ
ਆਖੋਂ ਸੇ ਦੇਖਾ ਇਹ ਮੇਰਾ ਲੜਕਾ ਮੁੰਡਾ ਬੜਾ ਛੋਟੀ ਸੇ ਮਾਰਾ ਲਾਠੀ ਸੇ ਐਸਾ ਸੋ ਰਿਹਾ ਲੜਕਾ ਹਮਾਰਾ
ਦਿਨ ਬਰ ਦਿਨ ਆਪਕੀ ਜ਼ਿੰਦਗੀ ਆਸਾਨ ਹੋਤੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਨਹੀਂ
ਜਬ ਹਮ ਹਮਾਰਾ ਅੰਤਕਾਲ ਹੋਏਗਾ ਨਾ ये दुख तो तभी भूलने वाला है बेटा जिंदगी में तो भूलने वाला ही नहीं ये तो नहीं भूल सकते
I didn't realize it was going to get tougher this journey talking to families who have lost several generations sons husbands grandfathers and all in the name of religion it makes me feel sick to the stomach I was just sitting there thinking For me, personally, my dad is my rock. I can't imagine my life without a father figure, without my dad. I can't imagine my life without my dad. And they've lost all their male figures in their family. And that's really hit me more than anything.
The tragic events of 1984 haven't been forgotten in Delhi. I've been told of a simple ceremony taking place that marks the year in a practical and moving way.
Hello, Sat Sri Akal.
Harvinder Fulker is a lawyer who's devoted most of his career to campaigning for justice for those who've lost relatives in the riots. He's behind a scheme to plant 25,000 trees right across Delhi.
This is in memory of those who were killed in 1984 and so that their memory goes into the history.
They will be remembered for the 100 years when these trees survive and they grow up.
It feels like a very positive thing that we're doing here.
Harvinder then invited me to plant a tree. I knew in whose memory I wanted to dedicate it.
Well, thanks for letting me do this because I'm doing this for Mahinda Kaur, whose husband was killed on a train, and all the other victims that I've met along this journey, really, for their strength. Put a special mark on this so that I recognise this when I come back. Thank you for allowing me to do that.
Oh, you're most welcome.
One group had tried to take refuge in their temple. It was set on fire, their bodies dumped in a ditch.
I have saved my friend's life. I'm proud of me.
A Although Harvinder's fight for justice and a proper inquiry into the Delhi violence continues, India today feels a more integrated nation. It even has a Sikh Congress Party Prime Minister. That evening, Sikhs and Hindus come together in a strong show of unity. Journey for me so far, but what's fantastic about this moment is that it's the festival of Diwali, which is the festival of light, celebrating the victory of good over evil, light over dark. All across Delhi, people were celebrating with the usual Indian disregard for health and safety. How much money have you spent on the fireworks? This was the first party I came across, and to say that after 2 days of reflecting on mob violence it came as a relief would be an understatement. Two families, one Hindu, one Sikh, enjoying the same festival. Politics and religion irrelevant. This is just one street. I don't want to read too much significance into it, but it's hard not to be moved by such a scene. I've returned home to Britain to explore the importance of 84 to Sikhs here, and to make some decisions of my own. In Britain, Sikhs watched helplessly as events unfolded in India. They demonstrated in their thousands and welcomed family members who fled the violence. Indrajit Singh is one of the leaders of the British Sikh community.
We protested, we wrote letters, we placed adverts in the daily newspapers. We did everything we could. It was reacting to the outrage that Sikhs wanted to demonstrate to the world. Mm. We are a minority. Please look at what's happening to our community. People came from all over the country, placards, criticizing the Indian government and drawing attention to the wider world about what was happening. It was a very emotional affair.
Over the course of time, what happened to that anger? Has it calmed down? Has it got stronger?
Oh, none of us can be angry for too long. We do calm down, but sometimes the hurt remains. And in India, in this country, the hurt remained.
But Indrajit believes that despite the hurt, British Sikhs have moved on and discovered a renewed interest in their faith.
Well, the events of 1984 made Sikhs examine their own religion. What is it? Why are we under attack? What are our teachings? You look again more closely at your religion at times like that. And when in looking closer and looking at the world around you, you realise that Sikh values, Sikh teachings have something very positive to offer. Emphasis on human rights and equality of all people, tolerance, real tolerance, respect for other religions. These things are very important in giving a sense of direction to life. So, in a sense, that is something positive that came out of the trauma of 1984.
As I near the end of my journey, my head is in a whirl. My questions are now more personal than political. Learning about 1984 has affected me deeply. But what should I do now? Should I be making changes to my life? I'm heading north to meet a young woman who I hope can give me some clarity. 1984 has played a huge part in Ravinder Kaur's life. I find her at the Gatka martial arts class in Doncaster that she runs with her husband.
This is Gatka in full swing.
They wanted to take the anger they felt at the events of 25 years ago and channel it into something positive.
Gatka is, as much as it is martial, is very spiritual as well.
We come from such a rich history, it's criminal to almost leave it behind. Bless us with the ability to be able to carry on this martial art. bless us with the
leading this class is just part of a dramatic change in Ravinder that started when she read an account of the assault on the Golden Temple.
I remember coming downstairs, looking at my dad and just falling and crying. And he said, you know, what's wrong? And I said, I cannot believe that something of this magnitude has happened with us. Mm. And I'm, you know, here I am, completely lost. I don't have a clue as to who I am.
So before you were baptised in 2005, was your hair short? What was it like?
My hair wasn't short, but it was curly. You know, I didn't have a turban. I didn't, you know, I didn't dress
did you,
the way
did
that
you look
I
more like me?
Absolutely.
And are you more content now?
Prior to 2005, I'd walk with my hunched shoulders, you know, down the street. And I was almost, to be honest, I was just another brown face in the crowd. To me, that's what I was. Now I walk with a presence. Mm. And that presence is only there, I can say absolutely most definitely, it's only there because of my turban.
I admire Ravinder Kaur for the changes she's made, especially her decision to wear a turban. And I keep thinking of all the people I was told about who were attacked or killed because they wore a turban. I've realised for the first time quite how important it is for a Sikh to be identified as a Sikh. And that's made me question how I look and practice my faith. If I'm honest, I'm a Sikh who's bending the rules to suit herself. I'm avoiding the tougher decisions. And even though I feel guilty, becoming baptised would be a huge challenge. Never being able to cut my hair would be very difficult for me to follow, especially as a woman living in the West doing the job that I do.
I don't know whether I will ever get to that point. Who knows? At the moment, I'm still travelling on that path. I'm not quite there yet.
But I've experienced something I never thought would happen. For the first time, I actually feel connected to my full Sikh name.
After going on this journey, that's the one significant change that I have really, really felt. I'm so proud of the name that I was given by birth, my proper full Sikh name. And the frustrating part of this is that I can't go back to being just Bhindranwale Sikh. Do I have to be Sonia Diol? Because that's how everybody knows me. But if I could, I would right now change it to just Bhindranwale Sikh, which just makes me feel brilliant inside.
As for the events of 1984, the attack on the Golden Temple should never have happened. It was ill thought out and the repercussions were devastating. I used to think 84 was all about politics. Now I think it's about innocent people and the high price they've had to pay. I can never again visit India without feeling the grief and sadness of those I met. It'll always be a beautiful and sacred place, but the bloodstains on the marble have told me a different story, which will be impossible to forget.